Okay. Well, good evening. As we gather here as an opportunity to look at our lesson, we're looking this summer at the reading scriptures with discernment. And I think that's something that we all could do more of is looking at, with discernment at the scriptures. And the session's aim is to help us think and gain wisdom that can transform knowledge into understanding, with the idea of producing maturity and character and guiding us to apply what we understand to how we live. So that's the overall goal for this quarter, is in our session to read scripture with discernment. My name's Larry Ginrich, and I serve as the Director of Communications and Engagement here for Landis Homes and Landis Communities, and I'm glad to be with you and be looking at, together at what we are going to be seeking to gain wisdom and discernment for this evening. Last week, we looked at Moses, the bringer of the law, and Jesus, the interpreter and fulfiller of the law, and looked at Deuteronomy 28 and Matthew 5, if you remember that. This week, we move on, and we're looking, beginning on page 8, at God speaks to us through the prophets. Session one, I said, we learned about Moses and Jesus. Now we're going to look about John the Baptist and how John prepared the way of the Lord by preaching a baptism of repentance and the forgiveness of sins. And then looking at Jesus and how he was a fulfillment of some of these prophetic texts. And do some interesting thinking about what that means to approach texts that are prophetic, and how do we interpret them, how do we understand them, and how do we apply them to our daily lives. So I thought we'd start then this evening with a prayer. Dear God, be here with us this evening. Create a sacred space. Help us to walk together in your presence unashamed. We ask the Holy Spirit to guide our conversation. Dear God, prepare our minds and hearts for this Bible study. We thank you in advance for the new awareness, insights, understandings, and inspirations your Spirit reveals. May the wisdom of the Spirit direct our words, thoughts, feelings, and actions now and during the rest of this week. And help us to follow Jesus faithfully. In his name we pray. Amen. Now, one of the things that it gave an opportunity to do for the leader today was to blow on a ram's horn. And I chose not to do that, partly because I don't have one of those horns, but partly just because I'm not quite sure what Jake would do back there if I started blowing a horn into this microphone. But many of you know some about that tradition and that horn being blown as the horn of a ram, and the priests in the context of our Old Testament sounded it off at important religious services. And in this context, we're specifically thinking about it in the Day of Atonement. It was blown at the start of the Day of Atonement, where people were to repent of their sins. And that got me thinking, okay, I didn't grow up in a tradition where we blew on a ram's horn as a symbol to get us thinking about that part of life, of repenting and seeking God's forgiveness. But what were some of the symbols or rituals or other prompts that I can think of that reminded me of that in my life? And you may have some of those in your lives as well. Symbols or rituals or prompts of things that help to seek out God's forgiveness for wrongdoing. One that stuck with me, even though it isn't something I currently practice, when I was young, I would go to my grandparents' church, and they always, at one point in the service, would turn around and kneel for prayer. And for some reason, that always put to me the idea of kneeling in front of God and kneeling and asking for forgiveness. And so for me, that's one of those touch points, that if there is a time of kneeling, coming before God, that may be something along the lines of a tradition or a ritual that helps me to think about repenting of my sins. I don't know if any of you have that. If you do, why don't you share that, and I'll repeat it so those who are watching elsewhere or cannot hear as well can hear it. But is there a ritual or a tradition in your own practice that you think of that might be similar to the blowing on of the horn? Anything you can think of? And we aren't as much of a symbolic tradition as the folks in the Old Testament were, I don't think. I don't think any of, particularly in our Western churches, aren't as symbolic by nature. Many churches in other parts of the world would have more of symbolism in their times of worship, and some other traditions do, but the Mennonite and Anabaptist tradition has not always been quite as symbolic when it comes to those things. Let's look then at the two scriptures of what we're looking at today. And as I mentioned, we're talking about John the Baptist and some of the proclamations that he was making. And as we look at this, it's important to remember we have two scriptures today. One is Malachi 3, and the other is Luke 7. And I'm going to actually look at them in the opposite order that they're printed in your book on page 8. So I want to look at the Luke chapters or the verses first. As we get to that point in the New Testament, Jesus had just finished an open but veiled conversation with two of John the Baptist's disciples about Jesus' messianic status. They ask on John the Baptist's behalf, "Are you the one? Are you the one who has come, or do we to wait for another?" And then Jesus explains some of the things about his work, and you can see that if you want to, and we'll look at that in a bit on page 8, coming from Luke 7. Let's first then read Luke 24 down through the end of verse 35. So the messengers were there, and they have left, and then Jesus begins to speak about John the Baptist. And he said, "What did you go out in the wilderness to look at?" If you remember, John the Baptist was out away from people. He was a little odd. He had gathered a group around him. But what did you go out in the wilderness to look at? A reed shaken by the wind? What did you go out to see? Someone dressed in fine robes? Look, those who put on fine clothing and live in luxury are in royal palaces. What then did you go out to see? A prophet? Yes, I tell you, and more than a prophet. This is the one about whom it is written, 'See, I am sending a messenger ahead of you who will prepare your way before you.'" He goes on, "I tell you, among those born of women, no one is greater than John, yet the least in the kingdom of God is greater than he." And all the people who heard this, including the tax collectors, acknowledged the justice of God because they had been baptized with John's baptism. But by refusing to be baptized by him, the Pharisees and the lawyers rejected God's purpose for themselves. To what then will I compare the people of this generation and what they are like? They are like children sitting in the marketplace calling out to one another. We played the flute for you and you did not dance. We wailed and you did not weep. For John the Baptist has come eating no bread and drinking no wine, and you say he has a demon. And the Son of Man has come eating and drinking, and you say, look, a glutton and a drunkard and a friend of tax collectors and sinners. Yet nevertheless, wisdom is vindicated by all her children. So why is it that John the Baptist's ministry was such a mystery that people were willing to walk out into the desert and hear from this person and be baptized by this person who didn't fit in, who dressed odd, who ate odd things? I think it was a beginning or a continuation of this search for meaning and this search for authenticness. And people were tired of seeing the leaders in their faith community living in the big houses and being all dressed in finery, and they were looking for something real and something different. And so they followed John the Baptist. Luke 7:27 says John the Baptist represents the fulfillment of the prophecy that we will read about in Malachi 3:1. John was the messenger sent to prepare for the coming one. John did that by refining and purifying. That was baptizing people and calling them to a time of renewal. And then Jesus shows up. So Luke's text here clearly shows, as it says on page 10, that Jesus is no less than the embodiment of Israel's God arriving on earth to fill all of the ancient promises. Back in Luke 3, it talks about John's ministry a little bit more. And then if we go back to the Malachi section, it's where we can get one sense of how Jesus's work was fulfilling the Old Testament prophecies. And it says on verse 10, or on page 10 here, the Old Testament prophetic passages almost always find their ultimate fulfillment in Jesus. Yet frequently the ancient prophecies had partial fulfillment before the coming of Jesus. That was something that stuck with me as I read this. It wasn't like there was nothing and then boom, there was Jesus, right? There was a progression. There was a ongoing partial fulfillment of this prophecy, and Malachi is a place where that shows up. So if we go back here on page 8, if you have your text with you, Malachi 3:1-4. See, I am sending my messenger to prepare the way before me. And the Lord whom you seek will suddenly come to his temple. The messenger of the covenant in whom you delight, indeed he is coming, says the Lord of hosts. But who can endure the day of his coming, and who can stand when he appears? For he is like a refiner's fire and like fuller's soap. He will sit as a refiner and purifier of silver, and he will purify the descendants of Levi and refine them like gold and silver until they present offerings to the Lord in righteousness. Then the offering of Judah and Jerusalem will be pleasing to the Lord as in days of old and in former years. So what Malachi was talking about, or what Malachi is saying here, is that there is going to be someone who's coming and preparing the way. And there are other places in the Old Testament that have this look, have this start to feel like there is a change happening before we get to Jesus, but it is not fulfilled in its final fulfillment until we get to Jesus. As it says on the top of page 11, but none of these were final fulfillments. Only in Jesus can our sacrifices be fully pleasing to the Lord. The sacrifices of pure praise and of doing good and sharing with others, quote, for such sacrifices are pleasing to God. And that's from Hebrews 13. And then it says, one day the New Jerusalem will descend to earth, and the physical temple won't be needed, for God will dwell fully with God's refined and purified community. And that's talked about in Revelation chapter 21. Then will be the full fulfillment of the Malachi prophecy. But when Jesus is there, Jesus has the opportunity at that point to talk to some of John the Baptist's disciples or people who were hanging around him. And he is trying to help them understand what's going on. Jesus claims that everything written about him in the law and the prophets must be fulfilled. And he offers that perfect sinless sacrifice once and for all. And so Jesus also was an unexpected vessel for this prophecy. John the Baptist was not the only unexpected vessel. Yes, John the Baptist was a little unique. He went off into the wilds of the desert and he found scavenges his food. He dressed different, he talked different, he acted different, he baptized differently. But Jesus was a different package too. Yes, he maybe looked more in line with the rest of the way people dressed and ate and drank. But Jesus was the son of someone, in the earthly sense, the son of someone that many of these people might have known. Jesus was a normal person in this sense. And so he did not fit the mold that they were looking for. If you remember, Jesus had a couple of disciples who couldn't figure out how this person could be the fulfillment, right? And many of the people who tried to follow Jesus or who wanted to follow Jesus struggled with that as well. Well, how can you be the person who's going to overthrow Rome? You know, we had one of his disciples, Iscariot. They were the ones who carried knives around and stabbed the Romans. You know, we had zealots who were in rebellion against Rome. They were looking for someone to come in a very dramatic and regal way and take over and bring in this new covenant by force. Bring in this new kingdom by force. Jesus didn't fit any of those profiles. So even though it was a part of fulfilling that prophecy, it was also unexpected. And Jesus starts, as he often did, by asking questions to the crowd or the people around and asks some questions that we might either consider odd or kind of hard to get at. What did you go out into the wilderness to look for? A reed shaken by the wind? Well, that wasn't what John the Baptist was. John the Baptist had a very singular purpose in mind, to prepare the way for the coming Messiah. He wasn't flopping back and forth. You know, if we hit these branches, right, they move based on the wind that hits them. John the Baptist was right on his mission, his path. And Jesus was praising John for that. He was saying, this person is on the right path. This person is helping to plow the ground so that I can come along and be a fulfillment of this prophecy. If you look back to verses 29 and 30 from Luke, I'll read that here. And all the people who heard this, including the tax collectors, acknowledged the justice of God because they had been baptized with John's baptism. But by refusing to be baptized by him, the Pharisees and the lawyers rejected God's purpose for themselves. So again, unexpected news, right? It wasn't the Pharisees and the leaders who made this connection in their head. Oh, this baptism is a part of preparing me for God's kingdom. It was the tax collectors and the normal people who were making that connection. The leaders, the more educated people who had read these scriptures for years and years and probably had most of them, if not all of them, memorized, they weren't making the connection. It was out of the box of what they assumed this prophetic word was going to bring. They were looking for something different. The people responded to John. Maybe it's because he was different and on the edges of society. Maybe they had not felt welcome in the temple. Certainly we know from other parts of the scripture, the tax collectors weren't very popular. I remember one of my classes along the way, somebody saying that tax collectors were so known for being crooked that they weren't even allowed to testify in court cases because it was just assumed that they were going to lie and cheat. Now, I don't know if that's true or not historically, but the idea was that they were not a strong member of the community because they had defiled themselves by being participants with the Romans. And yet, those were the folks who were saying, we understand that this baptism is moving us toward faith, moving us towards understanding. But that gets us to the Malachi part again and this whole idea of prophecy and how does prophecy work. And if you look at page 11, if you have a book with you, about a third of the way down, it says, so how does prophecy really work? And the writer talks about a perspective comparing the prophecies of the coming one to job opening announcements. Who is the successful candidate? The announcement might read, the successful candidate will have these qualifications, these unique abilities, and these priorities, and now you need to apply. We've seen that, right? We see that in every Help Wanted ad. These are the qualifications to even think about applying. These are the things we'd really like for you to have. If you qualify, if you have some of these things, take that next step and put yourself out there as an applicant. I thought that was an interesting way to think about prophecy working. And then a little bit later it says, who ultimately is the successful candidate? The one who can fill that role. In biblical prophecy, Jesus turns out to be the successful candidate. And then the writer says, that does not mean ancient prophets knew all about Jesus in advance. It means that God had made promises and would see to it that they would be fulfilled, and in Jesus, they are. As Paul aptly puts it, in Jesus, every one of God's promises is a yes. That's from 2 Corinthians 1. So partial fulfillments may have happened. Even Jesus' life and death and resurrection are only a partial fulfillment of the final foretaste of God's kingdom come again. Our job as followers of God is to carry on that work of Jesus, bringing greater and greater fulfillment to what God has promised. And then when Jesus returns, all of the promises will be fulfilled. That was a helpful way for me to think about prophecy. Because I guess it, kind of in my mind, I had this idea that a prophet who is making this pronouncement knew the end of the story. That God had come to these Old Testament prophets and said, thousands of years from now, you know, many generations from now, I am going to bring this person who is my son. That's not the way it worked. It was a looking through a glass at something far away, but given enough information to tell that story, to give that prophetic word, so that the children of Israel at that point could understand and move toward that better understanding of God's desires. The lesson writer then jumps back at the bottom of page 11 to John the Baptist and says that Luke 7 does have some puzzling aspects. And it says, people don't go to the desert to look for what is always there, talking about the reeds, or what is never there, people who are dressed up fancy, they might go to see if God is finally keeping the ancient promise of a messenger. People were seeking an authentic messenger for God's word. This was a time of troubles. They were under the control of Rome. They weren't being able to worship as they wanted to. They weren't able to do what they wanted to. They were under someone's thumb, if you will. And people were seeking out, is this possible that this person out in the desert is preparing for the coming one? And they were not disappointed. God fulfilled a promise through that. And then it says on page 12, John was the last and greatest of all of these preparing for the era of fulfillment. Now, we don't live in that era, right? We have seen this fulfillment of Christ coming down, living as a human, and yet being wholly divine. At his baptism, it says the Holy Spirit descended upon him on bodily form like a dove, and the voice of God identified Jesus as God's Son. That's from Luke 3. Jesus is part of the Trinity. In Luke 7:34, Jesus refers to himself as the Son of Man. This identifies Jesus with our humanity. And so this idea of being wholly human and authentically human and wholly divine and authentically divine, and how do we look at that? What do we do with that dichotomy of human and divine? I found it helpful on toward the bottom of page 12. It says, being followers of a merely human Jesus who teaches and demonstrates the life, the right way to live and love doesn't work. And the New Testament has no merely human Jesus anywhere. And then a line that I have underlined in here, it says, I grew up with the opposite error, conceiving of Jesus as merely divine in a human disguise. And I think, I think that's something that many of us may have thought at one point. Jesus was really divine just wearing a human skin, right? Just wearing that skin of a human, but was fully divine. But what the scriptures and what the prophets had been calling for was someone who was a divine presence, but also, in this case, fully human. And to keep that intention within us, remembering his full humanity and his full divinity, sometimes can be difficult. And it makes me wonder, what kind of messages do I remember from my childhood about Jesus's divinity and humanity? And what messages have I been giving on to my children about Jesus's humanity and his divinity? And you might ask yourself the question, as it does on the top of page 13, do you relate to Jesus as merely human or merely divine? Or do you relate to Jesus as fully human and fully divine? The next section on page 13 asks us to rethink biblical prophecies and says prophecy at its heart is about covenant faithfulness. And it works in two directions. God using prophets to call Israel back to faithfulness, encouraging, warning them, promising them. The promises are sometimes predictions, but as already claimed, it's not about God peering into the future. God is creating that future and doing together with God's co-workers, humanity, and in particular the covenant community. So prophecy is about our covenant faithfulness to God and God's faithfulness to us until we reach that promised future. And what's helpful is that God uses both kinds, it says there on the bottom of page 13, both kinds, the greatest and the least. So John was the last person who was calling out this leader that was yet to come. So he was the least of society. He dressed different, he acted different, he approached things different, but he was given a significant leadership role. And the rest of us quietly and humbly go about our daily tasks, trusting that our acts of faithfulness contribute to the great kingdom-building project God is doing. But I think in doing that, sometimes we sell ourselves short. We are integral parts of the fulfillment of this prophecy that goes back to the Old Testament. Our work at creating and growing God's kingdom is to be that next step until we get to the point where Christ returns and we all see the new kingdom. Our job, our role, is to be a part of the fulfillment of that. Sometimes that could be overwhelming, but I think it's pretty clear that that's what we're called to do. We are to be part of transforming the existing into the new. We aren't just to be looking backward and say what used to be. We aren't just looking forward to say what will be. And it doesn't matter what happens around us because I'm going there and it's all going to be happy, hunky, you know, everybody's going to be eating ice cream or whatever it is we like to do. But, you know, so it doesn't matter what happens here. It's both. We're to be looking backward at those Old Testament prophets, at John the Baptist, at the disciples, and take that information and take those prophecies and move the ball forward so that God's kingdom can keep growing until it's here in its fullness. And I think if we are honest with ourselves, and we were to have some time of quiet and write down what our contributions are to the kingdom, we'd probably all sell ourselves short. There are many times that acts that we do help grow the kingdom that we either don't know we've helped to grow the kingdom or we don't want to talk about it because it's seen as being proud. But the reality is that that is what we are called to do, is to be the movers of the community of believers forward, helping to move that community along and transform it. The writer of the lesson help says, "The followers of Jesus carry on the work of Christ under the new covenant of salvation by grace until Christ returns. Prophets used encouragement, warnings, and promises to call us to that faithfulness. God's faithfulness is steadfast and moving along toward this time when salvation will be fulfilled." And so I would leave you with two questions for the rest of your time of preparation until Sunday, and maybe you can talk about this on Sunday if you have the opportunity. How do we discern the focus of biblical and contemporary prophecies amid the noise that's all around us? And by noise, I mean people who have called themselves prophets, who have said things. I remember thinking about one person who was making prophecies that the Lord was going to return in a certain year. And I was really disappointed because there were some things I was looking forward to that I wouldn't get to do. I don't know that that's quite what we're meaning by listening to prophetic voices. But how do we listen to and follow true discernment and true prophecy when there's lots of noise around? And then how do we live in a covenanted faithfulness with God in this in-between time? In this time after Christ has come, after this fully human, fully divine Christ has died on the cross and rose again, but has not yet returned, signaling the fullness of that. We're in that in-between time. And how do we live in that time and live with others in that space? Some of us had the opportunity to hear from J. Nelson Crabill 2 weeks ago when he talked about his new book, Stuck Together, and talking about how do Christians navigate this world where we don't always agree with each other, but we all see ourselves as on a path to follow Christ faithfully. And I think that's one of the big questions of our time is how do we use prophecy and how do we use steadfastness to inform how we live with each other when we don't always agree? I would like to think that while Jesus was fully human and fully divine, it's that third part of the Trinity, the Holy Spirit, that guides us as we try to discern. Anabaptist Mennonites have often talked about discerning together, learning and thinking, what does the Bible have for us? What is the Holy Spirit trying to tell us? And doing that in community, as opposed to having it sent from on high in terms of a hierarchy of church leaders saying, this is how we discern. It gives us the opportunity to celebrate that we are co-creators with God in this covenanted community moving toward its fulfillment when Jesus comes again. So as I said, go through the rest of your weekend thinking about those things. And then next week, we aren't going to be looking at prophecies, we're going to be looking at visions. Slightly different angle, but still another tool that's in the Old Testament and the New Testament, another tool that's used to help move us to a faithfulness to follow the call of Christ, to follow toward God's ultimate renewal of the kingdom. So I hope that was helpful for you. I hope as you go through the rest of your evening and the rest of the weekend, it gives you something to think about and that you can use this idea of taking a John the Baptist prophecy, seeing it fulfilled in Jesus and looking forward to its ultimate complete fulfillment when Jesus returns and we have the new kingdom for all of us. Let's pray. Thank you, God, for giving us the opportunity to learn from prophets. Ask that you would give us the clarity of mind and spirit to understand better how to recognize prophets among us and prophets that we need to pay attention to. And ask that you would help us to together move forward as the people of God in covenant faithfulness.